All right. Good morning, everybody. We are going to get started. Happy Friday. Woo, Friday. We all made it to Friday. Good week. All right. Welcome to Rotary Club of Maplewood, North St. Paul, Maplewood, where we work to change lives locally and globally. We are going to start with our Pledge of Allegiance. I'm going to ask Norm to get us started. We have a flag in the back. Thank you. Carolyn, would you lead us, start us off in the five-way test?
Oh, I forgot this. The five-way test of the things we think, say, and do. Number one, is that the truth? Number two, number three, number four, and number five, is it fun?
Great, thank you. And then Brian, will you lead us in words of encouragement or invocation?
I will. I'm going to lead you in a little invocation. If you would bow your heads, please. We ask our creator today, we ask for the peace that we're all looking for. We ask for the blessings that can be given us. We ask that as Rotarians, we continue to do the good works that we normally get due. We also ask that you keep Barb Buckley in mind today as she has a funeral for her father. With this, may you bless all. Amen.
Thank you, Brian. And was everybody greeted this morning? Excellent. Thank you for bringing the extra treats of delicious donuts. Where are those from? Pine Tree Apple Orchard. So if you didn't grab one, go grab one. Randy Greenlee, do we have a Friday morning wake-up quiz? The answer is yes.
And good morning. I do have a Friday morning wake-up quiz. And last week's response time, 83%. So remember, we're looking for a person, place, thing, or event. As soon as you think you know the answer, yell it out loud enough that I can hear it. Number one, things used to be more black and white than they are nowadays, and these clues are old school. Just a touch, and I'll be yours. I am brought to light in the dark. I am most pleasing when I'm well developed. Photograph is correct. Film was close. I tried to give it away, I guess. Number two, I serve the best in town. Cosmo is one of the few who really understood me. If you want some, you had better follow the rules. The soup Nazi is correct. And the no soup for you. Number three. There are many explanations of how I came to be, such as from the Choctaw word for it is so. Some say I was the initials of Martin Van Buren's nickname used during his presidential campaign. Maybe I'm from the French, the name of a place in Haiti most famous for its rum. I could be from the Greek, a word meaning all is well. Am I from the Mandingo for all right? But gaining widespread currency during the 1840s, most favored expression popularized by Van Buren's All Correct. It's okay. Yeah. And does anybody know his nickname during the presidential campaign? Old Kinderhook, which was a question a couple years ago.
All right, time for one lovely sergeant at arms.
The singular arm, I think. Good morning, everybody. I have a fun story from something this week that involves our Rotary Club indirectly, is that I got to go to the Twins game Tuesday night from the tickets from the raffle at the auction. So as I'm at the game, I took my grown children, my 25 and 22 year old, and the three of us went to the game. It was really a treat to be able to do that with together. We don't necessarily have time all the time to be able to do that. So I'm at the game and I get a text, and I look at the text and it's Joe Stallman. And he says, "What are you doing these next couple of days?" I said, "Well, what can you be more specific?" And he says, "I'm not going to be able to use my last two tickets to the Twins. Would you want them?" I said, "Well, that'd be great." I said, "In fact, I'm at the game tonight." He goes, "You are?" I said, "So am I." So as we did that, kind of sorted out, he's about two sections over, and both of us stand up. We're at the Twins game together at the same time. So I'm going to put in a couple of happy dollars just for that, because that was a real nice treat, totally unexpected, and did not know that, one, we were both going to be there at the same time. But on top of that, that was a very generous offer. So got to take a friend of mine on one of my baseball teams to the game the next. So I went two nights in a row, which is kind of fun. I can't remember the last time that's happened. That's a ways back. And one last update on baseball, just for fun, is the championship weekend last weekend was for our team. We won the first game 5-1. We lost the championship game 2-1. And so our record for the year was 21-1. So we got second place, and it was a really close game. And the pitcher we faced that day with that afternoon was really good. And we just couldn't figure him out, couldn't solve him. So we did get some hits, did get some run, but could not. Tying run was on third base in the last inning. We could not get that last tying run across. So great season, but ending 21-1 with a 2-1 loss at the end. So I'll put in a couple of dollars to start off our happy bucks today. Who else would have some things they'd want to share, or some things maybe they want to contribute to some happy dollars this morning? Do I see any guests on here? I see Elizabeth on there. Is it maybe frozen? Or that's one really big cup of coffee. And I see there's George is there as well, so not a visitor, but
I think they're all frozen.
Must have been something I said. That baseball story was really bad, apparently. Just even caused technology to stop. Here we go.
Well, I have some numbers from the shoot I thought I'd share with you. This deals with the guns that the club purchased to put in the shoot and how they paid off. So first of all, we sold 90 big tickets. So that was $9,000. The first shotgun, which somebody in here won, was called the Shooters Only. So we don't actually sell any raffle tickets for that one. So technically we make $0 on it. We give it away. You have to be a registered shooter. You can't buy another ticket. But we had 117 paid shooters, 112 which showed up. So 117 paid shooters at $250 brought in $29,250. And for that, we gave a $900 shotgun away. So I thought that's a pretty, valuable little addition towards somebody who paid $250 to come to our event. Second shotgun went in as a big ticket raffle. Now that was also $900 of value. And for both those shotguns, the club paid $660 for that shotgun. So there were 90 tickets for that shotgun sold at, I priced them at $20 a ticket. But they're in the envelope, $150 worth of tickets for $100. So if I discount the value of that ticket by two thirds, that's about $13.50. So on the 90 tickets, we took in, but in addition to that, $120 worth of tickets at the table for that shotgun. So we took in a total of $1,800, making over $1,000 profit on that shotgun. Now the history on that is, we used to put them in the auction. The problem with the auction is nobody pays $1,000 over the price of a shotgun. So the most we ever made was $100 over cost, and the closest we came to losing money was $10 over cost. So $1,000 over cost is the raffle pays off better. And then our two ace pistol salespeople. At 52 cards, we take in $1,040 for each pistol. And the 1911, the club paid $400 for that gun, so we made $640 profit. And the Glock, the club paid $480, so we took in $560 profit. So I thought that's a pretty good return on investment. And we are now out of stock of guns, so we want to start looking for next year.
Does anybody else have any happy bucks? Where's all the happy people at? Come on.
Yeah. Happily sleeping still.
All right.
I need change though. Sorry. I'm cheap. No, I need it for the weekend.
I'm happy because we're going to a friend's cabin this weekend. So we leave today. Cumberland. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And thank you. That's okay. Yeah. So I'm looking forward to that. And maybe we'll get to paddleboard too, because that's where I first got to paddleboard. And then I bought my own. So I'm excited.
Awesome. That's for Suni Lee getting on Dancing with the Stars. So that goes to, because you support our Asian community here. So that's for the Salvation Army. Very good.
Wonderful. Thank you.
I don't have a dollar today. I owe all of you a dollar. Not individually, at the collective group, to clarify. My husband, Andrew, is in his last test of the week. He's had 5 this week. And if he does well, he gets to come home for a whole week.
Awesome.
So there was motivation to study a little extra for him this week. So, yeah, it'll be a fun week.
Just think it could have been recorded and saved forever. Anybody else? Any other happy bucks this morning? Well, let's go ahead and do a drawing for, looks like some, this must be a pine tree apple orchard basket, I would think. Pick your own. Darn right.
319.
Thank you.
I gave you that.
You did give it to me.
Yes.
I turn it back over.
She did hand that ticket to me. Thanks for stepping in the other arm.
TV timeout.
Commercial.
Come on. I'd be nervous to ask the group for a quick commercial because you never know. All right. So we have a couple announcements. So please make sure you sign up if you are able to attend the visioning sessions. They are November 9th and 11th. We want to get as many people as possible. Hopefully 15 to 20 members is our goal. They are going to be on Zoom. So hopefully that makes it easier to attend those days. But we have a sign up at the front. We'll keep that going. Next week, our greeter is Jennifer Meyer. And I am looking for somebody to help out with breakfast next week. So if you could help out with that, that would be great. Please let me know. Otherwise, one of you is going to get a phone call from me on Monday or today if I'm on top of it. And then birthdays. This week, we have Char on the 4th.
Happy birthday.
Anyone else have any announcements?
I have a question. I don't have a way to deliver that table that I promised on October 9th. So if anybody can pick it up and drop it back off, that would be great. I think it's a 10-foot table or something like that.
At Rotary Park?
Does someone have a truck they can pick up a table?
Woo! Thank you, Terry. Terry's got a truck.
Send Terry your information.
Thanks, Myra.
Thanks. We got most of it filled out, but I'll send it around again. I think we need one more person at the membership table on for the first shift. But we would like everyone there probably around 10 o'clock to start setup. The event starts at 11 o'clock. I don't see Joe. So we'll do our presentations right around 11:30 or so. Until whenever they end, and then there'll be live music. The Boy Scouts were there with food. There's not much to set up, a couple tables, couple tents, and some audio equipment. But I will send this around if you want to sign up for something. Great. I think that's all I have.
Thank you.
Sean?
Yes. Yep.
I'd be glad to help with what else needs to be done there for next Saturday. I'd be glad to help.
Helping at the membership table?
Okay. What do I need to do for that?
So that's 11 to 12:30, it's basically we'll have brochures about membership. And if someone comes up to the table, tell them how great our club is.
Okay.
And that they should join.
Thanks, Ann.
Okay.
Any other announcements from the group?
I am still looking for people to participate in my Trunk or Treat event. Saturday, October 30th, 3 to 5. If you're interested, I would just ask that you bring your car, your candy, and dress up. Anything you want to be.
Within reason.
Within reason.
You know who you are. Yes.
I think we're over that. The whole COVID stuff.
That was still last year. All right. All right. For our speaker today, we have Elizabeth, who has joined us in her presentation today. We're going to look at the system and benefits of yoga's sister science. Correct me if I'm saying this wrong. Ayurveda. Hopefully Elizabeth will tell us how to say that. And hopefully we can gain an understanding of how your own body type and tools and help towards better movement and balance. All right.
Elizabeth, take it away. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you. Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm Elizabeth. I live up the road from Myra and in Shoreview. And it's just an honor to be presenting to all of you. I see some of you out in the tables and then online. So it's really beautiful. Can I share a document?
I got it. Yes, you can.
Okay. So I'm going to share just a little bit what this is, just a few slides here. And so I'm going to attempt to explain an entire medical system in 20 minutes. Okay, so this is a little bit of a challenge, but I think what you'll find interesting is that at the end, we're going to look at how this health system, ancient health system, it's a holistic health system, looks at the immune system and immune system response. And so I'll give some tips on what this system says and what advice Ayurveda does give us to prepare the body for kind of any invaders, okay, which we are experiencing a little bit. I mean, we experience them every day, but this one in particular is a little bit sticky, right?
Elizabeth, can you put it in presenter mode so it shows up a little bigger on the screen?
Yeah.
That'd be great.
So my little menu here keeps popping up, you know? Okay, let's see. There. The only thing is I can't see any of you when I do in presenter mode. So is that okay? That's kind of one of the problems. Let me see if I can do, let me see if I can make it a little bigger like this. How is that a little better?
Yes.
Because then I can see some of you as well, which.
Yes, good. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. Okay, so Ayurveda is the sister science to yoga, and it's older than yoga, if you're familiar with yoga. And I'm just going to go through and kind of tell us about this. So I've been studying, just to kind of give a background, I've been working on studying yoga and teaching yoga since the 80s. And Ayurveda is something that I've been studying for about 7 or 8 years, probably 8 years now. And it's really a passion of mine. It's a complementary practice to our Western medical system. So it's a preventative care. Ayu means life or longevity, and Veda means science or sacred knowledge. So Ayurveda is kind of how we say it in Sanskrit. It's a Sanskrit word. Sanskrit's one of the oldest languages that we know of today. And this holistic health system is about 5,000 years old. It's older than Chinese medicine. So if you're familiar with acupuncture, or if you've had any kind of Chinese remedies, then this system predates that. And it actually is quite similar, right? It's a very similar style of healthcare. It uses lifestyle, diet, herbs as treatments. It encourages us to be an active participant in our healing process, right? And it's really about preventative care. So it's, I like to call it the prehab, so we don't have to rehab, right? So that's another way to kind of look at this this work, this science. It's related to yoga in that its roots are in the Vedic sciences. So the Vedas are the ancient teachings that are some of the oldest teachings in the world. And we're going to take a look a little bit at the philosophy that this science shares with yoga. Yoga means union. Union, what are we unioning? We're unioning mind, body, and spirit, or sometimes people use the word breath because spirit and breath are synonyms. If you look at the Latin root for spirit, it means to breathe. So when we're unioning the mind, body, and breath, in yoga, we actually are helping ourselves stay well, right? In our mind, body, and breath. yoga is the treatment that Ayurveda uses to help maintain balance and help realize the self. As we recall, knowing thyself is a very strong edict, right? It's one of the most challenging things to do in life is to know who we are, right? So the six philosophies are called the Shaddarshan that Ayurveda and yoga participate in. So I'm not going to go too much into this because it gets a little bit philosophical, but just to know that a lot of the Ayurveda is based on science. So there's three primary scientific philosophies that Ayurveda and yoga participate in, and that is Samkhya, which is the journey of consciousness into matter, and it's a very elaborate journey. And then there's Nyaya, which is the science and logic of logic and reasoning. So it has a lot of ways in which that it does a double check, right? It checks things out. The other more scientific side is Vaisheshika, which is a critical analysis of reality, matter, and antimatter. So this is where some of the first conversations around the atom began. And this is five, 6,000 years ago. The other philosophies that Ayurveda participates in or borrows from these philosophies is, you may have heard of Vedanta. It's this concept of oneness. It comes from the Vedas, or what happens after these ancient texts. And then we have Purva Mimamsa here, which means investigation. So it's how we analyze and understand things thoroughly. It uses rituals of practicing our duty, like our duty in life. And then we see yoga down here, the path of self-realization. There's four paths to yoga, and there's eight different styles of practices to yoga. So yoga we think of in the West as oftentimes we think of young, skinny females wearing beautiful clothing, you know, that are very expensive clothing, and doing these very complex postures that we can't get ourselves into ever in our lifetime, right? But yoga has a lot more to it than that. Actually, 4% of yoga is what we see in the commercial world. So 96% more to do. according to Ayurveda, health is where doshas, and we're going to talk about these concepts called doshas. Doshas are balanced, and our digestive fire is balanced so that what we eat gets turned into nourishment for our tissues, right? And then the tissues in the body, right, and the waste products are working in a normal state. So you're going to hear some words that you don't typically hear at a conference, like your urine and your poop are coming out as they should in your sweat, right? And you're taking in food and it's nourishing your tissues, so there's no depletion, right? And the Sanskrit is sam dosha sam agnicha sam dhatu mala kriyaha. That's the Sanskrit for these slokas, or these phrases or aphorisms that teach us. The ancient texts are in these kind of phrases that are our lessons. And they used to be chanted over and over, and that's how they were recalled, because there wasn't a computer or paper or pen back in those days. And so they would chant or use repetition to memorize these phrases that helped us stay well. The whole principle, the reason why that this science even got started, is because there was suffering, and we all have that. There's not a single soul on the planet that it has no suffering. And so because suffering existed, we needed to do some practices to help stay well. And we didn't have ibuprofen, we didn't have antibiotics, right, back in the day. And so we had to use different techniques. And they would have a lot of time to study this too. So they looked at the physical body, and the physical body actually is a microcosm to the macrocosm we live in on this earth and in the universe. And so they use these elements in nature, these cosmic principles, to relate to our physical body. How are we doing? Raise your hand if you feel like you're following this okay. I'll just a little bit. Okay. Somewhat okay. All right. Thanks for participating. So space Space is one of the elements in nature, right? Space, air, fire, water, and earth. And we see these. We know we live inside of space. There's air that we breathe. Fire, we know the sun is there. And we know things cook when we put them on fire. And we have water in the oceans, water in our tap, thank goodness. And we live on this beautiful planet Earth where we can plant things. So we have these elements in our body as well. So who can name a place where in the body we have space? Anyone can just grab a microphone or come up mute and just say, where do you have space in the body?
For example.
Sorry?
Joints.
You have space in your joints.
Mm-hmm. Joints, lungs, your stomach, your brain.
Yeah. So hollow organs, right? How about in your mouth?
Isn't every atom 99.9% empty space?
Perfect. Yes, there's more space inside of an atom than not space. So we are actually more space than not space, but we think we're solid, right? So that's kind of good. Yeah. How about air? Where do we have air in the body?
Lungs.
Lungs. What was that one? I couldn't hear that one.
Blood, intestines.
Yeah, we don't like them in our intestines too much, do we? Yeah, sometimes there's air in places we don't want it to be, right? How about fire? Where do we have fire in the body?
Our heart.
Yeah.
The solar plexus.
Perfect. I can hardly hear the ones, the folks in the actual room. So I apologize if I can't hear you, but yeah, fire is our digestion. How about, can you see without the light of fire? If the sun went out, could you see anything? So there's fire in our eyes, right? And your skin is warm, right? If you touch your skin, it's nice and warm, thanks to fire. How about water? Where does water live in the body?
Everywhere.
It's 80% depends on your constitution, which is what we're going to look at. But some people have a little more water than others. And then earth, where do we find the earth in the body?
Under your fingernails.
Yeah, your fingernails. Your bones, right? All solid organs, right? That's very earthy. So we are that, and that is us. And that's one of the main principles in how Ayurveda uses its technology for healing. And so we use these things. I'm not going to go through this one. It's a bit complex, you know, it's just too much. But the gunas are called these qualities that are within us. So you can see clear, the ether or space has clear, cold, light, and subtle. If you got launched into space, you'd be cold and you would be floating, you'd be light. And there would be, it would be very subtle, right? And same in our mind. So if our mind, for example, because our mind is part of our body, right? If our mind is spacey, we've got these terminologies, right? We've got, oh, she's a space cadet, or he's a, or they are a space cadet, right? And so we have these qualities that have been around, we know, we call them this, right? Or we have the air element, which is very mobile. Air is the only one of these that moves. It's the one that causes the most trouble in the body, right? It can be very healing, but it can also be the one that kind of pushes everybody else around. It can push the fire and we can get too hot. It can push water and we can have a wave of edema, right? We can have a wave of water compiling somewhere, right? It can push the earth and we can have blockages in our heart, or we can have, you see? So air pushes stuff, all right? Fire is hot and sharp and light and dry and oily. Water is heavy, right? If you got hit by a wave, you'd probably topple over, right? It's also cool. So someone who has a lot of weight, who has a lot of water and earth, they might be heavier. And typically we think that I have a lot of weight, I don't know why I'm cold. Well, because water and earth are cold. And so sometimes there's a misnomer in our culture that, oh, because I have a lot of weight on me, I should be warm, but I'm actually cold, right? Because these elements are cool. Does that make sense? So someone who has more earth is going to be heavier. Someone who has more space or air is going to be a lighter frame. And so we call these things doshas. So Ayurveda uses these three concepts, vata, pitta, and kapha. Vata is comprised of, and these are our, at conception is when this is determined. And your balance, your makeup, your genetic structure happens at conception. The sperm and egg come together, the mom and dad's, however they are at that moment, comes together and makes this, or the dad and dad or mom, you know how it goes these days. And then there, all of a sudden, the baby's constitution is, and our constitution is determined, also called our humors in the Greek world, right? Vata is space and air. Pitta is fire with a little bit of water. And kapha is earth and water, right? So we're going to get back to this language, vata, pitta, kapha, okay? So as we know, we can see back in the day, it was called a mesomorph, endomorph, or ectomorph. You may have heard of this terminology. So the Greeks kind of, they did a lot of trading back in the day across the seas. And so the Greeks took on a lot of this knowledge, right? Or came up with it at the same time. So mesomorph is the pitta, right? A little bit more muscular. Kapha is heavier. It's earth and water. So it's going to be a little heavier. And then vata, no matter how hard the vata tries to lift weights, they're not going to build that muscle because that's earth, right? Muscle is earth. In Ayurveda, it says that no ease or dis-ease is imbalance. And it's called vikriti, which is a word you don't have to know. But think about whenever we have lack of ease of those elements, the natural element that happened at conception, when that comes off balance, say my constitution is more vata, air, because I'm thinner, and pitta, because I have sharp eyes, right? I'm sharp and I can, you know, typically people have a little more heat as well. But when those come off balance, all of a sudden I have lack of ease or dis-ease, and that's where disease comes from. How do we determine this thing called our constitution? There's three main ways that Ayurveda uses to determine, like, how do I know what measure of water and earth and air I am? So there's observation. So a clinician or a doctor of Ayurveda will look at your body frame and your shape, right? And your structure and your mannerisms. And that's observation. The other way is through questioning. So there's like a Q&A that happens that we kind of dig down deep. And the other way is through touch or physical exam. And one of the ones that in particular that's quite unique to Ayurveda, and I believe the Chinese medicine does it as well, is pulse diagnosis. And it's not taking your pulse like in the West. It's doing a pulse with the three fingers that represent each of those doshas, vata, pitta, kapha. So that's how we find out. And you can also take a quiz, and I've put a link here, and I can also put that in the chat if anyone wants to know, or you can just Google what's my dosha, and you'll find out what percentage of water, earth, and air, and all of that you are. So in balance, how are we doing so far? Raise your hand if you're doing okay. Yeah, it can get a little, this is a whole medical system that I'm just really boiling down here. So vata in balance, when the space and air elements are in balance, we have a natural sense of quick, light dryness. So you might notice that people who get up and down from their chair quickly and easily, and they're the ones that are more mobile, because this is the only mobile, you know, air is the only thing that moves, right? Everything else gets pushed by it. But in the mind, the air, the movement can be very creative and imaginative. So if you want to have, if you have a team that you're putting together, put people who have more vata on the creative team, right? They're very spontaneous, changeable. They have a lot of sensitivity because air is the sense of touch. And so there's a lot of sensory skills that someone with vata has. Quick movement, they're usually smaller in their body. And because they're out in space, and moving a lot, they're cold. So cold hands, cold feet. Then we have vata. Pitta in balance, with this is fire with a little bit of water. Usually there's a sharp intellect because fire is sharp. They're very driven. These are the articulate decision makers. The leader of this group, right, would be probably more pitta. To be successful, having someone who in leading a group, having someone with more pitta is advantageous, right? They're also sensitive, but they're sensitive to hearing, seeing, smelling, and tasting, and touch. So the sensitivity is a little different from vata. There's a good sense of judgment, very good critical thinking, right? They're on fire, right? They're moving and exploring and assessing, right? And they're organized and efficient. And you might see yourself in some of this, right? They have a medium build. They don't gain or lose weight very easily, whereas vata will lose weight easily. And they have a very strong digestion. These are the people who get hangry, right? They can eat anything. These are those people. And then kapha, with earth and water, they're usually stronger and heavier, more stable, take a little long to make decisions. They're wise and loving and sweet. They're very sweet. They have a long memory. These people are the ones who can recite the conversation you had 2 weeks ago, verbatim, right? They have a good memory. They're compassionate, forgiving. There's a lot of calm patientness to them, loyal and steady. These are the people to put on long-term projects, right? They're cool because they're in water and earth is cold and they have a slower digestion. So might not be able to eat as much. So the principle of Ayurveda is like increases like. So if I have a lot of fire in my body and I eat spicy, fiery foods, I'm going to get more fiery. Does that make sense? If I have a lot of air and gas in my body and I eat popcorn or have a salad, which is very drying, I'm going to be dry and airy, right? So this is what happens. We increase our element to come off balance, and opposites balance. So if I have a lot of gas, I want to take in something that's more grounding, right? Like that. So imbalances of vata. So the wind is blowing too strongly. So spinning, dizzy mind, excess movement, fear, anxiety, tics or twitching, right? Hyperactivity, attention deficit, right? Difficult to remember things. Easily distracted. You're saying, oh, that's me. When we go into later phases of life, this happens. We move into the vata phase of life as we get older. We get drier, right? We dry out. And so we tend to have a little more constipation and gas and drier skin. You might find it right now, the season that we're in, you see the trees. The trees are losing their water in the leaves. The leaves are drying out, and you might find yourself having drier mouth, drier eyes, or drier skin because it's the season of vata and we're getting drier. So it's important to take in more water, right? When vata is unbalanced, we crave things that keep us unbalanced. So we'll crave those dry, crunchy foods, right? And we might have trouble sleeping. Imbalances of pitta are inflammation. So phlegm is a flame. And inflammation is fire. Anything that's an itis, right, is going to be an inflammation. Sometimes an imbalance means we have a sharp tongue, a little sass, right? Can be judgmental and angry when we're off balance. Fast digestion, so maybe some diarrhea will occur. We have ulcers or acidity or reflux because there's too much fire in the digestive tract, right? We're very sensitive to light. So if you go outside and the sun is shining brightly, if you're very unbalanced, you'll find that it's harder to be outside in the light. We have rashes or acne and things on the skin that are turning red. Red is fire, right? Aggressive mind or obsessive and compulsive, you know, thinking. Very perfectionist or competitive. When we fall into these things, we're like, oh, I better maybe do some opposite things and cool down a little bit. Maybe take a swim in a cold pool or take some nice herbs like cilantro that help cool us down. Kapha, look at this baby. I mean, in the early phases of life, we are in kapha phase. And we're squishy and we're watery because we need to grow. And so heaviness, lethargy, and dullness happen when we're off balance. We have a lot of excess water and swelling and retention. More fatty deposits, obesity arises. Mucus, because kapha lives in the lungs. And so there's phlegm issues and congestion. Slower mind, depression, and sadness occur. And we feel stubborn or stuck, right? And we crave sweet foods. So how do we balance vata? Well, the number one way to calm that mobile quality is to create a routine. And so waking up and going to bed at the same time every day is super important for vata to calm that mobile quality. Things like meditation or rest, taking a little more rest, maybe sleeping a little bit longer if you're able to. Eating nourishing, warm cooked foods, right? Warm cooked instead of cold and crunchy. Grounding spices like nutmeg, ginger, cinnamon, right? We're starting to, like, even if you go to the farmer's market, you're going to find more pumpkins, right? And we add spices to make soup. You know, things like that. It's kind of natural in Minnesota to go into that mode of, you know, thinking about our spices in our pies and our soups. And then doing a slow, steady yin yoga practice that is very stable, lots of stability required. And that's how we balance vata. To balance pitta, who's on fire, right? We want to surrender control, to let go, because the pittas will want to hold on and try to control everything, right? So they need to chill out and slow down. Non-competitive activities, having timely meals so they're not hangry, right? Avoiding hot and spicy foods. Cooling spices like cardamom, coriander, and cumin are just lovely. Using lime instead of lemon. Lemon is more heating, lime is more cooling. And then a surrendering yoga practice, so like a restorative movement. And it could be just taking a slow, long walk instead of going jogging at lunchtime. So a lot of times I see people who are lots of pitta and they'll be jogging at noon in 90 degree weather. And probably they get angrier, right, in life. And then kapha, we've got get up and go. The kapas are, if they're too unbalanced, they're not going to get off the sofa. They'll want to stay on the sofa or stay in bed until 9 or 10 in the morning. But getting up and out, moving that body is the opposite quality. We're going to seek variety, ask for help. The kapas don't ask for help because everything is fine. Choosing a daily exercise, same time every day, right? Reducing heavy sweet foods. Sorry, I think I heard someone say they brought donuts. And I'm a donut fan. I love donuts. But sometimes if we're feeling heavy and dull and sleepy, having a donut would make you more so. Yeah. And taking in warming and invigorating spices. So warm because we have the cold quality of earth and water. So we want to have warming foods, but maybe a little more spice. Black pepper helps with digestion, right? Clove, turmeric, mustard seeds. Yeah. And a vigorous yoga practice. So the hot yoga you may have heard of, these people going into these hot rooms and doing like tons of postures. This is the person who needs to be there. All right. How are we doing? So far, so good. This is my last slide, I think. So when we look at immunity in Ayurveda, we look at how can we stay balanced in the mind, body, and breath. So doing breath practices and keeping your body balanced. So finding out what your constitution is. If you're 50% pitta and 40% kapha and a little bit of vata, then you probably need to chill out a little bit, right? And find your balance. Find your balance. Being in balance, remember the definition of health. Being in balance means the doshas are in balance. Our digestion is flowing and our tissues are nourished. So immunity is dependent upon all of these things operating to be health. If we're healthy, we will be resistant to anything that doesn't serve us, right? So some tips from Ayurveda this time, right now, around boosting our immune system is first, of course, is balancing your dosha, balancing your body and mind. Drinking clean, warm water throughout the day cleanses the body. Not too much, because if you have a lot of water, if you're already kapha, if you're already water and earth, you won't need as much water as someone who's dry and out in the ether, right, in air. So people who have more air and ether will need to take in a little bit more water. If we take in too much water, we will kill our digestive fire if we have a lot of water already, right? So there's the flame in our solar, someone said solar plexus. The solar plexus is where all our digestion happens, right? Not all, but a lot of the food digestion, let's say. Taking on turmeric, not the pill, because the pill takes out a lot of the pieces that are valuable. The whole herb is what Ayurveda says is the most important way to get the qualities that are required for the systems in the body. So taking either a slice of turmeric or using the powder, but not the tablet. Coriander, cumin, garlic are all good for the respiratory system and reducing inflammation. Right, eating fresh foods. So visit the farmer's market if you can. Having recently picked fruits and vegetables, really hard to do in Minnesota, right? As we come up into winter, we're kind of limited in what we can select. So going to the farmer's market and using those fresh, or having your own garden, of course, is great. There's also a jam called Chayavan Prash, and it's a little bit funny spelling. But this Ayurvedic jam is very healing and boosts the immune system. It has a fruit in it called the amalaki fruit. And the amalaki fruit in the food kingdom has the highest vitamin C per dose that we know of. And so we know that vitamin C is extremely useful in this form, especially for building the immune system. Chayavan Prash has about 30 herbs in it. And so it's got a lot of things that are nourishing the whole body. And so taking 2 teaspoons to 1 tablespoon depends on your dosha with warm water every morning as advised. Drinking tulsi or holy basil tea. Tulsi is excellent for the respiratory system. And you can add a little cinnamon or black pepper to that or have some ginger tea. It's very good for the cough and respiratory issues. Same with licorice. I didn't put that down, but licorice is really good for the respiratory system and the throat. If you have a dry throat, if you're talking a lot, have some licorice tea. And then you can add to the tulsi, you can add turmeric and make some milk of your choice to make like a golden milk is what the Chinese call it. And then nasal application. So Ayurveda uses oil, a lot of oil, because oiling the body is good for the nervous system and it nourishes the tissues from the outside in. And we can take it orally. Right now, it's important to take in a little more oil so that we're not so dry, right? It goes against what a lot of the Western advice is for taking margarine or low fat, blah, blah, blah. But Ayurveda believes that good quality fats are essential to the whole system. And then daily practice of yoga or meditation to modulate our stress. Stress is a huge part of our immune system response and promoting our fitness and strengthening our lungs. So I think that's all I have. I hope that was interesting for you. And if you'd like to ask any questions, I can hang out. I don't know how much time we have, but
we have about 5 minutes. So questions.
I have
where do you find that tea?
Tulsi tea. You can find it at, I don't know if you guys are all from the local area, but Fresh and Natural or has Tulsi tea. It's made by Organic India.
And the jam.
Sorry?
Jam too. Where do you get that?
Oh, the jam, the jelly. So there's an Indian, I buy all my stuff online because I like certain brands, you know, but you can get it online. So you can type in Chaya Van Prash jam in Google and order it online. Or seasonally, there's a Indian grocery store right off of Lexington and County Road E. There's an Ace Hardware there, and it's right across from Cub, and there's a Walgreens there, and there's an Indian shop that's called Surya. Surya means sun. And they typically have it as we come into the winter season. It's very seasonal for the Indian shop is not necessarily Ayurvedic. So the Indians actually had Ayurveda taken away from them. The British came, and for 200 years, they would cut the hands off of people who would practice Ayurveda and their tongues and things. So the British did quite a number on this science,
We just loved your presentation. Is there any way that you can send us your slides?
Well, I can remove the, I don't have approval. Like I didn't get copyright approval for the images, but I can take the text and send you the text if you would be interested in that.
Thank you.
Sure.
Question. I have actually two questions. One was the doshas, and when I think of endomorph, ectomorph, and I think of the genetic makeup for those three different categories of body types, and then you were describing the doshas and kind of mixing them up with the different body types. But it seems like when you look at the doshas, there is possibly environmental factors that can play a role and maybe switch your dosha around. And you were kind of talking a little bit about some of the elements that can affect that. So how do you kind of reconcile those ideas?
Mm-hmm. Doshas? Excellent question. So the doshas that are formed at conception, it's called Janma Prakriti. So there's many, now this is like, I just gave you like a snowflake on Mount Everest of what this is about. Okay. One snowflake on Mount Everest. And so there's different levels of Prakriti. There's different levels of constitution. Okay. So there's the constitution at birth, and that never changes until you die. And that is your perfect state of balance. Then we have, after conception, we have 9 or 10 months, depending on what culture you're from, you have 9 or 10 months, right? And you're living in this environment that is managed by your mother and your environment. So if you're conceived during wartime, or if you're conceived during a pandemic, right? There, if the mother and father have stress, then there's going to be something that goes on in that genetic makeup, right? So we're looking at progeny. You know, this is a bigger picture. And then there's the time in the uterus that we all are there. And then what happens in there, right? And then the first birth, the first breath that we take. And then that might be another, a little derivation from what happens at constitution, from conception, I mean, right? And then, so there's things that start to happen, and it's called your vikruti. Your vikruti is your imbalance. And imbalances can start after conception all through your life. So you could be born with a constitution and then be deprived of something in life, love, nutrition, right? All these things start to happen, and they start to bring you off balance, and you start tipping over, right, in the scale. And all of a sudden, now your imbalance happens. And then things go on in life, and we just get more and more imbalanced. And it shows up in the system like depression or anxiety or arthritis or indigestion, right? Or all the diseases are formed from the lack of having balance. When we're in balance, we're healthy.
And then I have another question, because it seems like there is a lot of foods involved regarding trying to balance some things in your doshas. So what is the idea from Ayurveda regarding fasting? Since that's kind of
It's a trend right now. Intermittent fasting is something that I'm working with my clients on a lot. Mm-hmm. And fasting is depends on your dosha and what you're trying to balance, right? So someone who has vata and pitta, they really need nutrition and food. So if they go into a fast when the fire is hottest in the midday, then they're going to have probably more imbalance, right? Depends on what they're working on. Someone who has more kapha, right, can probably do more fasting. But fasting in Ayurveda, or we call it cleansing, cleansing in Ayurveda always takes in food. It's not about no food. It's about which food, mm-hmm. right? So there's a food called khichdi, and it's a rice and bean and spices mixture with oils. And so that, if you're going into a fast or a cleanse, you would take a portion of that certain times a day, and that would be your cleanse, right? Intermittent fasting, Ayurveda says that after, there's times, right? So there's times when there's vata, times when there's pitta, times when there's kapha in the day. And so Ayurveda says to have the most efficient digestion, it's best to eat your meals at the same time. Have breakfast by 8, have lunch between 11 and 1, and have dinner before 6. And then don't have anything at all between 6 or 7 at night until 6 or 7 the next morning. Give yourself that intermittent fasting would be your sleep time, because the nighttime is where the mind has its rejuvenation and digestion. The daytime is where we take in food and we nourish this thing called our food body. This is our compost pile. This is my 2020 edition of me, right? Because we lose all of our, right? We rejuvenate. And so this is Elizabeth 2020. And how I eat this year will be Elizabeth 2021 next year. It's very, very logical, right? So that the fasting should occur as you sleep. The body will either digest or rest. It won't, if you eat a lot of food before bed and try to go to sleep, the body will have to make a choice to digest. And then the sleep is restless. Very good question.
I got one quick question. You said have a slice of turmeric. Is turmeric a root?
Yes, it is. It looks like ginger. As a matter of fact, if you go to like the Indian shop, one time I bought a turmeric piece of turmeric. And the person at the register was like, you know, this isn't ginger, right? I said, yeah, I know. It's turmeric. So yeah, you can, I think Fresh and Natural has it. I think a lot of the, you know, like Mississippi Market, all of those co-op type shops will have it.
Well, thank you, Elizabeth. That was very informative. Hopefully we all had a good takeaway of something to work on. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was lovely. Couple other updates before we leave. Meals on Wheels today is Randy. So thank you for doing that. Next week, our speaker is Christina Sorio, superintendent of 622. Super excited to have her join us. April agreed to take on food for next week. That's what I have. Yes.
Sure, I got a question on Meals on Wheels. Last time I was there, it was a construction mess, and I kind of got lost.
Go to the last storage building. Or was it there?
Yeah.
So to the right of that?
Close to the parking lot, so both still going there?
Yeah. It's the turn of under control.
To recap for our friends on Zoom, if you're doing Meals on Wheels, there is some construction. So go to the door by the north parking lot. Okay. With that, thank you everyone for attending. We'll see you next week. Meeting adjourned.